Yeah, no, definitely. So, yeah, I suppose we'll launch into it. What book did you choose? And one question I do ask is, when did you read it? Because I'm always interested to find out when people, sometimes when you read the book at a certain period of time, it has a specific meaning to you.
Yeah, it's a really good question about the timing. I've picked Rough Ride by Paul Kimmage, or A Rough Ride if you were reading it when it came out in its first edition. And the first time I read this was not when I was that young or anything like that. I think you were reminding me that I'm 10 years out from my leaving cert before I came on air. You'd found that out on my LinkedIn. So probably would have been a few years after that, because like sports journalism wasn't necessarily something I wanted to do when I was in leaving cert. So it was a few years after that when I realized that sports journalism was something that I was interested in that I picked up this book. And I don't know when exactly it was. I do remember kind of only having half an interest in the Lance Armstrong saga in 2013 when he did that Oprah interview. I think the whole world was watching that. But that was kind of as that was the extent of my relationship with cycling as a sport at that time. So I think it was actually when Team Sky were coming to the fore and there were serious questions about them. And when I started to work on Off the Ball, that I was like, right, I need to go back and do a bit of reading here. And bought Kimmage, bought a couple of the David Walsh books, bought the Tyler Hamilton book, actually bought Lance Armstrong's first book himself. And they're just incredible. It lends itself to incredible writing, cycling.
And so you say kind of sports journalism wasn't on your radar. Were you a big sports fan always growing up? And in particular, did you have interest in cycling? Because for me personally, cycling is not a sport that I have much interest in at all.
Yeah, no, I definitely would have been the same as you, that cycling wasn't really on my radar whatsoever. Maybe TG Cahir during the summer, during the Tour de France when Lance was at his peak. That was probably the extent of my relationship with cycling when I was a kid. But outside of that, sport obviously was a massive thing. You can't grow up in Kerry and not have GAA as the very fiber of your being at certain parts of the summertime from July into September. That is what you obsess about, which is Gaelic football. I mean, my father was a fanatical Arsenal fan, and he passed that down to me, unfortunately. But even the likes of the Invincibles, I remember where I was when they won that particular when they won that particular Premier League trophy. So, like those two things in particular, Arsenal and Kerry football, were the two things that definitely accelerated my love for sport. And then there was a whole array of other things that I would have paid load of attention to, but I'm not going to sit here and say, yeah, cycling was one of those things, because it wasn't. It definitely was way down the list of sports that I would have paid attention to. And in a weird way, I got into it like as part of my interests via all the controversies and via Lance, via Team Sky. That's what brought me into cycling. And people say this is a bad look for cycling and this is not good for the sport, all the controversies. It's actually the thing that made me a fan of cycling, to be quite honest with you.
That is really interesting, because I think, yeah, most people think the opposite. And I suppose from this book, it's obviously Paul Kimmage is so invested in cycling that it's such a negative for him. But for us who don't have that much interest in that, it just gives us kind of a cool story to read about. And I suppose, could you give just a slight synopsis of what the book actually is and who Paul Kimmage is for those that aren't fully aware?
But Paul Kimmage was one of the best Irish cyclists in the 1980s. People don't ever talk about him like that because he wasn't the best Irish cyclist in the 1980s. The two best obviously would have been Stephen Roach and Sean Kelly, and even Martin Early, who comes up quite a bit in the book and would have been one of Kimmage's great friends in the 80s, would have all been considered better cyclists than him. But to be in the top five Irish cyclists at the time was still something, given Stephen Roach was the best cyclist in the world for a period of time. So he rides a couple of Tour de Frances. He doesn't finish them all. He abandons them in pretty horrifying style, actually, which he details in incredible fashion in the book. But he manages to finish one. And to finish one Tour de France is an incredible achievement. It's something that maybe people don't quite realize. Even coming last in the Tour de France, even being the Lanterne Rouge, is a massive achievement for a cyclist. And if you use your knowledge of other sports, and that is your prism for viewing cycling through, you're probably not going to understand how important that is and how much of an achievement it was that he got to the end. So he may not have been the headline cyclist, but he was a professional cyclist. He was earning his keep with a professional team, a number of different professional teams. He decides, though, to spit in the soup, as they say in cycling, by writing this book, by talking about not only his story and his struggles on the bike, but also the required nature of doping that exists in cycling and the omerta around that. Basically, he details his first use of amphetamines, his use of caffeine tablets, the, I guess, liberal use of needles all throughout the peloton in professional cycling, and put it all down on paper in 1989, which was a little bit too soon for cycling. This was not something that the sport was ready for, and Kimmage got roundly castigated for it. Now, I will qualify that by saying he won William Hill Sports Book of the Year pretty much immediately after it came out. So from critics, it was acclaimed immediately, and rightly so. But really, it's not until 1998, till the Festina affair, that people are like, Kimmage was right. And people started to realize what he was saying was actually a really important piece of journalism. And he was speaking the truth. And he'd actually lifted the lid on a lot of things that a lot of Irish people, let's face it, weren't willing to accept in the late 80s.
Yeah. No, it's fascinating. The whole story is so fascinating. And I suppose one of the reasons that doping is so prevalent in cycling in particular is how hard a sport cycling is. And that's one of the things he really gets across. And one thing, it's so raw, all the heartbreak that he has. And there's one quote, I think, at the start that his dad says to him, because his Paul Kimmage's father was also quite a good cyclist. I don't think he never went pro or anything. But he said, Paul, in cycling, you will experience more heartbreak than happiness. And then I think Paul Kimmage says something, you know, oh, dad, how right you were. But it's so true when you continue to read on in the book. Just even the losses that he has and the times, particularly when he has to abandon the tour, when he sees the Irish flag with his name when he's in the car and how ashamed he is. There's something about the sport that is just so all-consuming for the people involved.
Yeah, and the fact that departing the tour and quitting is the biggest stain you can possibly put on yourself. Like, it's an entire chapter. July 22nd is the name of the chapter, and it's the best chapter in the book, really. It is the story of heartbreak. Like, in many ways, I guess the sport of cycling is an interesting case study in masculinity in some way, and I think Kimmage touches on it a little bit, where the process is head down, drive on, stoicism is encouraged, keep your secrets to yourself, don't speak out. The silent, tough type is what cycling likes. Like, in many ways, like, I know people compare quite often the peloton to the mafia. And like, there's a quote early in the Sopranos when Tony Soprano makes that very point. Why can't all men be like Gary Cooper and actually have that quiet, silent confidence about themselves, and they don't need to talk about their own feelings? You kind of get an air of that when Kimmage talks about the peloton and the idea of giving up on the 22nd of July that year, and how that tore him apart completely, that it was worse than the doping. It really, if you compare the two things in his perspective, giving up and letting your team down a little bit, that was the thing. And you're right. One of the reasons why doping is such a big thing in cycling, and has been a big thing in cycling, is the fact that it's just a ridiculously difficult sport. But also, I guess, the protection of those secrets is something that's allowed it to thrive down through the years. And it's astonishing to think that people maybe weren't that aware, or were taken aback, or didn't believe Paul Kimmage when this book came out, because you had people like Tom Simpson in the 1960s who died of an amphetamine reaction, basically, of going up Mont Ventoux. There were many, many cases before him. And as we all know, the 90s was just the Wild West when it came to doping as well.
Yeah, but I suppose as a supporter, you never want to believe the worst things about your sport. Sorry, like, say if we even take rugby at the minute with concussions, there's no one really that wants to tackle that head on, because, you know, pardon the pun there as well, but because it's probably going to ruin the sport if they don't. If you actually tackle the issue at hand, because otherwise you can keep letting it go and the sport will stay the same. We can have this great entertainment. But the reason that it's great entertainment is probably because of the risk that is there.
Absolutely. And the word entertainment is an interesting word there. And I think that's kind of nailed on the head, because concussion, if you think about it, is actually quite a boring story compared to the success of a team on the pitch. There's been a lot said about concussion. The science is out there. And even if we talk about concussion in the media, I'm not sure it generates as much interest, for example, as the actual rugby itself or the actual game itself. Now, I do think doping is fascinating. I do think there is way more intrigue to it than concussion, but it is along the same lines, that people just want to hear the good news. People just want to hear the entertaining stories. And what I always find such a contradiction about people who criticize Paul Kimmage and criticize people who've spoken out about doping in cycling is they come out with these lines like they're trying to make a name for themselves, or they're trying to, I guess, create attention for themselves, which just couldn't be further from the truth. If you want positive attention, if you want to make a name for yourself, you don't spit in the soup. Paul Kimmage, if you read this book, he wrote this book when he was 27 years of age, before he became a full-time journalist. It's brilliantly written. He is absolutely gifted when it comes to having a pen in his hand. You use the word raw. This is absolutely one of the rawest books you're going to read in sport, and it's poetic at the same time. This is somebody who would have succeeded in the media regardless of spitting in the soup. He could have got any job he wanted with Eurosport, with any cycling channel around the world. He could have showed up to the Tour de France every single year after he stopped riding, and he would have got really well-paid jobs being part of the tour coverage, or part of any Grand Tour coverage. He didn't need to do this. And it always kind of grinds my gears a little bit when people say, oh, he was just trying to make a name for himself by writing this book, because he could have made a name for himself in any other way, in a way easier way than it was to piss all his friends off.
Yeah, for sure. I think it's like cowardice to say things like that. And I think he was completely brave. And the big thing that Paul always gets is, you know, he's bitter. And he does come across as an incredibly angry person, like, you know, for whatever reason. I'm sure but at the same time, he obviously had an insatiable drive to become a cyclist. So that mindset must make you in some way a bit of an aggressive person to begin with. So I'm not, you know, maybe it's bitterness, but I don't think so. I've just a huge amount of respect for him after this.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think that pig-headedness is something that he would have shown in his journalism career afterwards, and still obviously shows in his journalism career afterwards. Like, there is a softness, I find, to Kimmage as well, obviously, in a very different way. I think maybe a lot of cyclists are like this, but even the way he like talks about Alpe d'Huez or Ventoux or the Galibier, he kind of like talks about these as opponents, but also in a sort of David Attenborough type way, where it's like this piece of nature which is my opponent on this given day, and I'm going to try my best to outmaneuver my opponent. And there's something so beautiful about it. I guess the fact is, he talks about France quite a lot in this book, and it just happens to be an extremely beautiful country. And maybe that's the simple reason why cyclists have that softness to them. But I do think Kimmage has that deep down. There's a real goodness to what he's trying to do, and a real goodness to his existence in the peloton as well.
Yeah, it's interesting you said that, because you know the moment in the book when he's getting interviewed by the journalist from L'Equipe, and I think the line is, you know, something like, you're too thoughtful to be a cyclist. And you really get that sense that, like the other, if he was just another cyclist, he would have doped and not thought about it. And you know that kind of line in the Tiger Woods documentary, you know, you need to learn to compartmentalize things, I think Tiger Woods said to one of his ex-girlfriends. I think Paul Kimmage could have been like that if he wasn't a thoughtful person, if he had just, you know, not questioned things, not learned to do things. And there's bits in the book where he's questioning, why does he have this kind of sense of integrity? I found that bit really interesting, and I think it's probably why he is such a good journalist now, because a journalist has to be able to be thoughtful and think about things in a critical way and think about things in a different way.
And that's what makes him such a rarity. Like, you're right, it's the shut up, put the needle in your ass sort of thing. That's the attitude that'll get you to the top in cycling, if you're Kimmage, if you're a domestique at the time. And it is just a complete anomaly that he happens to not have those characteristics, that if you remove Paul Kimmage from the cycling world, a lot of these things don't happen. There probably wouldn't be somebody who fills that void. There wasn't exactly people lining up to spill. Now, I think the same goes for every generation of cyclists. And you have, whatever it is, 20 years later, Floyd Landis being the next person to spill the beans. There hasn't been too many in recent years, because there isn't many people who will ever do this. And I think that it is a complete random occurrence that the person with this integrity managed to exist in cycling, because there wouldn't have been somebody else to step up. It wasn't the entire construct that affected Paul Kimmage to become somebody with integrity. He just happened to be somebody with integrity that got out of cycling soon enough for that integrity not to be completely broken, because you feel that if he was in the sport for another 5 years, he might never have done this. If he didn't have the gift of the gab and he wasn't verbally brilliant, then he might not have been able to do this. And that has a real impact on the sport as well.